Well, thank you, Dimitri, for your welcoming words. Thank you also for inviting me again to this conference honoring Hyman Minsky, that indeed the Great Recession brought again to the limelight of the community of economists. And his work really provides crucial insights, not only in identifying the key mechanisms by which periods of financial calm sow the seeds for ensuing crises, but also the specific challenges the economies face in recovering from such crises. Moreover, Minsky displayed a keen understanding of the damaging effects of uncertainty, not just on economic performance, but also ultimately on the fabric of civil society and democratic institutions. These insights have acquired renewed urgency in view of the worldwide resurgence of easy answers populism, whose simple but flawed solutions to complex problems become more appealing the greater the uncertainty. This year's conference has a very topical title: Will the Global Economy Environment Constrain U.S. Growth and Employment? Indeed, the prospects for the full recovery of the U.S. economy and the normalization of its monetary policy are of utmost importance, but can only be properly assessed in an international context. Conversely, international spillovers from the U.S. to the other economies must be well understood to appreciate the most likely scenarios for the global economy. 9 years after the inception of the Great Recession, it is no secret that economists and policymakers are baffled and disappointed with the lackluster nature of the ongoing recovery. The perplexities and anxieties generated by the present situation were summed up in a rather candid, open, and unexpectedly perhaps pessimistic way by the governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, in a recent speech, and I quote, "The global economy risks becoming trapped in a low growth, low inflation, low interest rate equilibrium," end of quote. But equilibrium implies a prolonged stable situation, and while that might be emerging in economic terms, the same is not the case in social terms. Or put differently, the social equilibrium is not stable. Advanced economies must either radically change their economic prospects by generating growth and jobs, or will be forced to adjust their social systems in uncharted ways. In the rest of my remarks, I will first discuss some of the hypotheses put forward in the literature to explain the determinants of this prolonged low growth period, sometimes characterized as a global liquidity trap. I will then review some of the proposed measures to exit from the liquidity trap, including fiscal and structural policies. While each of these measures has specific benefits, they also have limitations or are subject to constraints. Against this background, it is important to emphasize that while having to resort to non-standard tools, monetary policies also remain effective in fighting the global liquidity trap, even against international headwinds. For the euro area, I will conclude that only an encompassing policy mix can deliver stability and prosperity. The literature about liquidity traps and their international contagion is vast. A subset of that literature considers the implications of a liquidity trap in the open economy and highlights the importance of a global response to the trap. And I quote several papers that deal with these issues. For example, Olivier Jean, 2009 paper, demonstrates how a recessionary shock in a country can lead the world into a global liquidity trap. This is particularly the case when monetary policy interest rates reach the lower bound. Jan argues that increasing the expected inflation rate in both countries, in a two-country model, through monetary policy, if feasible, Is the more efficient response to the global liquidity trap more efficient than an increase in public expenditures in this particular model? This strand of literature is also linked with the savings glut explanations of the Great Recession. Put forward by Ben Bernanke in 2005, it was later used by him in 2007 and 2010 to justify our capital inflows at depressed US medium-term interest rates and fueled the subsequent housing bubble. Despite being contested, this hypothesis has been quite influential and supported since 2008 by the theory that explained the global imbalances by a shortage of safe assets in countries with underdeveloped financial systems. This was Caballero and Fari and Gorinchas mostly that did that since 2008. The ensuing search for those assets, particularly in the US, generated capital flows, decreased medium-term yields, and allegedly conditioned US monetary policy. Until 2008, the imbalances resulting from excessive savings in search of safe assets could be equilibrated by the decrease of interest rates. After the crisis, the decrease of yields was accentuated by the reduction of the stock of assets resulting from supply of weaker private issuers and from weaker European sovereigns. Interest rates were therefore pushed down to the lower bound, zero or now slightly negative, and the phenomenon propagated to other countries through the financial markets and the trend to equalization of interest rates. A recent paper by Caballero, Fari, and Gorinchas from last year, titled Global Imbalances and Currency Wars at the Zero Lower Bound, models what happened after the lower bound was reached. With interest rates variations prevented by the lower bound, the supply and demand of safe assets could only be balanced through recessionary variations of output. This would explain the weakness of the worldwide recovery and the temptation felt by all countries to try to use the exchange rate as a way to stimulate their own economy, hence the expression currency wars in the paper's title. The authors highlight that the US, by adopting earlier a very expansionary monetary policy, were able to benefit from a depreciating dollar, but this changed after 2014 when both Europe and Japan embarked also in a more expansionary monetary policies. Due to a non-Ricardian treatment of public finance, they use an overlapping generation model, there is a role for fiscal policy in dealing with the situation. The paper also finds that countries with more wage and price flexibility have a smaller share of the world recessionary trend, but at the global level, more downward price or wage flexibility exacerbates the global recession. The idea of a prolonged global liquidity trap is connected with the notion of secular stagnation, i.e. the possibility of a prolonged situation of low inflation and low growth at the global level. The secular stagnation hypothesis in this case refers to the demand-side version promoted by Larry Summers, where a trend of planned savings systematically higher than planned investment implies a situation of a persistence or persistent lack of demand and a negative output gap. Low interest rates and low inflation. The real equilibrium rate that ensures the savings investment balance at full employment may indeed become negative, as recent estimates for the US indicate. Eggerston and Merotra and Caballero and Fari modeled secular stagnation in a closed economy, and more recently, also Eggerston, Merotra, Singh, and Summers, in a paper of last year, presented a model of secular stagnation in a multi-country context, in which exit policies may include a global increase of the inflation target, if made credible, fiscal policy stimulus or capital controls for the countries with the domestic positive real equilibrium interest rates. The effectiveness of both monetary and fiscal policy is, of course, strong and amplified by possible international coordination of their use. So the whole literature on global liquidity traps provides an overall consistent narrative of how the world economy works and leads to a bleak outlook on the feasible exit solutions from the present quagmire. The first solution is credible forward guidance about future policy rates, linked to a somewhat higher inflation target in order to influence inflation expectations. Indeed, in the type of models used in these papers, forward guidance is the only available monetary policy tool, the measure that would more efficiently, if applied simultaneously by our jurisdiction, would influence inflation expectations. The shortcoming of this approach is the lacking of a sufficient credible commitment mechanism that would convince markets about the central bank committing to be irresponsible, between commas, no matter what. The second solution is to use the exchange rate as a policy target in order to stimulate growth via net exports. Obviously, this is a zero-sum game if all countries try to do it. Recently, the hope of some countries has been to depreciate against the dollar as a result of the US recovery, but the more recent months have proved that this is not an assured development, or perhaps the US is not ready to accept those consequences. I will return to this point later. The third exit solution proposed in the literature is the use of capital controls that would restore independence to national monetary policy so that neutral interest rates could differ across countries. This was also in the paper by Len Ray at Jackson Hole in 2013. For those with a positive neutral real rate, capital controls would avoid the fall into the lower bound. And it is indeed the case that the international community and the IMF have now lightly condoned the use of capital controls as a macroprudential tool in developing countries. However, the implications of the literature would be to use capital controls among advanced economies, an option that stands out and as unrealistic, at least to me, for political and ideological reasons. So the fourth exit solution is to use tariffs and protectionism. Already Olivier Jean in the 2009 paper illustrates the option in his model, but points, of course, that it would be less efficient. Going beyond models, a generalized rush towards protectionism would aggravate rather than solve the world economic predicament. The fifth and final solution is to rely on fiscal policy, the traditional way out in situations of liquidity traps. All the models concur with this prescription, which is particularly efficient in the lower bound and amplified if adopted internationally in an effort of international coordination. Fiscal policy, however, seems to be out of bounds in all major economies. In the euro area, fiscal policy is strictly conditioned by the legislation of the Stability and Growth Pact, and in the US, it is seemingly blocked by political partnership. Apparently, only if the state of the world economy deteriorated considerably would some governments step up the use of all the tools at their disposal. One can therefore understand the dispirited conclusion of Caballero, Fari, and Gorinchas in their paper. Unfortunately, and I quote, this state of affairs is not likely to go away anytime soon. In particular, there are no good substitutes in sight for the role played by the US treasuries in satisfying global safe asset demand. With mature US growing at rates lower than those of safe asset demanders, its debt and currency are likely to remain under upward pressure, dragging down safe interest rates and therefore keeping the world economy too near the dangerous zero lower bound. End of quote. Nevertheless, as I will argue later, this list of solutions of the global liquidity crisis dismisses too easily non-standard monetary policy tools. Thanks to such tools, international headwinds may hamper, but do not annul, the effectiveness of major central banks to influence economic outcomes. Before moving on to monetary policy, let me first recall that another proposed option to boost the recovery is to increase the growth potential in the medium and long term through structural reforms. And that is certainly very important looking to the medium and long term. However, structural reforms entail many times short-term contractionary effects. Egertson, Ferrero, and Raffo, in another paper of 2014, highlight such contractionary short-term effects that are amplified at the lower bound because they cannot be offset by expansionary monetary policy through a reduction in interest rates. A recent IMF working paper by Borden, Ebeck, and Shirono concludes, and I quote, that existing studies have shown that the long-run effects of structural reforms on growth and employment are positive. However, the evidence on the short-term effects of structural reforms is rather mixed and limited. And the recent World Economic Outlook that was just published has a whole chapter on this issue that basically agrees with these working paper conclusions. To summarize, the effects of structural reforms are contingent on the state of the cycle and the degree of slack in the economy, as well as on the accompanying stance of macroeconomic policies. That is why the IMF WEO pleads for the use both of structural reforms accompanied by fiscal policy where there is fiscal space, a concept that has several different interpretations. The G20 in their recent Shanghai meeting pleaded for the same approach, although one can be skeptical about delivery. We can recall the embarrassing results of the G20 agreed plan in Brisbane 2 years ago to generate an additional 2% in world growth above what was expected via a long list of concrete reforms put forward by the IMF and the OECD. Less than half was implemented, and in fact, the world economy now risks not even attaining what was then considered the baseline scenario. So on both the demand and supply sides, there are constraints to effective policy action. I'd like to add two key issues to this somewhat discouraging perspective. One that aggravates the challenges with a different version of secular stagnation, and another that offers some hope related to the role of unconventional monetary policy. The version of the secular stagnation hypothesis promoted by Robert Gordon in a series of papers and in his recent book is, of course, a supply-side phenomenon. The two broad frameworks for secular stagnation are not totally mutually exclusive. One emphasizes supply-side factors that lower potential growth, while the other points at chronic weakness in demand as the root cause of secular stagnation. Demand and supply factors may in fact reinforce each other because a chronic weakness in demand would amplify and exacerbate supply constraints, as for instance, persistent unemployment may hamper workers' sets of skills, therefore curtailing the productive capacity of the economy. So we all know what Gordon writes. I'm not going to repeat. I would have liked very much to be able to participate in this morning's panel where this was discussed, because indeed, even if the intervention by Bruce put some doubts on the Gordon version of secular stagnation, I don't agree with the way he concludes that out of his vision about these problems of structural evolution and transition from agriculture to industry and from industry to services. I find this structural view quite interesting, very akin to an old paper of the 1980s of Leontief, when there was also a big debate on automation at that time, and he pointed out indeed for this to this transition from agriculture to manufacturing, and concluded that indeed the increased productivity sector by sector would require in the end a big change in the distribution system in our economies to make the thing viable, which was also what Bruce concluded. So I will not go more on that, just to highlight that there are some easy answers to the Gordon approach by saying, well, there is a lot of innovation coming, technological progress has not ended, and that's true. The problem is, nevertheless, that the whole set of innovations that are on the pipeline do not seem to have enough economic traction, as contrary to what was the case in the first wave of technological change at the turn to the 20th century and after the Second World War. Those two waves created mass products that changed structures of the economy linked with urbanization, with women's participation in the labor force as a result of generalization of electric appliances and all that. And the new innovations do not seem to lead to this creation of mass products that generate income and jobs. And it is not an argument to say that, well, we should count the intangibles that are associated with the more recent innovations because they improve so much our lives and even our personal productivity. The point is that these improvements are mostly not paid for in a market. What we get from internet, from and these big firms that are beyond that do not create enough jobs. So there is no economic traction. And to count them in GDP, well, then transforms the GDP in a pure welfare indicator, but not in an indicator that is linked with what goes through the market, is paid for, and therefore generates incomes and jobs. So it's a very complex situation that will be even more complicated, as Leontief discussed in his very old paper, when robotization will be more generalized. So, this aggravates then, potentially, this supply-side story aggravates the problems of the world economy, and also justifies the fact that we have been seeing a decrease in the real equilibrium rate in advanced economies as a result of the declining real productivity decade after decade. Other contributing factors to this decline of the real equilibrium rate, the rate that would equilibrate savings and investment at full employment, also is the result of demographic decline, greater economic income inequality, and lower public investment. The declining equilibrium real interest rate cannot be ignored by monetary policy that grounds its rationale in real variables and tries to achieve a real rate that ensures macroeconomic stability with low inflation and a zero output gap. Facing the Great Recession and this development of the real equilibrium rate, central banks had no alternative but to reduce rates until the zero lower bound was attained. In other words, the low level of nominal interest rates in advanced economies before and after the crisis cannot be explained only by the savings glut view or by the shortage of safe assets theory, which is the mirror image of the savings glut, seeing it from the capital account perspective. These views provide an explanation for what happened to nominal market rates, but not to the evolution of the real equilibrium interest rate over time. What is more, monetary policy has a decisive influence on interest rates that cannot be explained by the loanable funds theory alone, which is behind the savings glut or shortage of assets views. Short-term market nominal rates are directly influenced by monetary policy rates and via expectations of future policy rates and risk premium, policy rates are also influence medium and long-term market rates. This means that monetary policy cannot escape responsibility for the low level of rates before the crisis. Although the central banks were pursuing their mandates and following inflation targeting regimes that excluded asset prices or other aspects of financial stability from their objectives, and that were their mandates. In the period of the so-called Great Moderation, they ensured low inflation and reasonable growth, while the financial system brewed credit booms and instability. The fact remains that central banks cannot pursue several objectives with the same instrument, and that in order to ensure financial stability, they need to be given regulatory powers of a macroprudential nature that can smooth the financial cycle by controlling leverage of the credit institutions. What happened before the crisis was a failure of financial regulation and supervision that did not react to excessive leverage, credit booms, and growing debt, believing in the rhetoric of the efficient markets hypothesis that blasts all market practices and accepting that the risk management techniques behind securitization and the originate and distribute model were sound and safe. To sum up, there are some good points against the idea that the savings glut or safe assets shortage views, while useful in understanding some key aspects of the present global economic framework, contain all the truth. They do not. In particular, they fail to fully capture the responsibilities of monetary policy of the major central banks, but they also fail to capture their possibilities. And turning to the challenges of monetary policy, the most obvious point to refer is that monetary policy went beyond the zero lower bound on nominal interest rates and is actually into negative territory, even though as there is a floor to negative rates, whatever is that floor, one can say that it only displaces the lower level further down. Lowering some key policy rates below zero has therefore been exploited to provide additional stimulus. While this monetary policy move is unprecedented in an historical perspective, it is entirely standard in its reliance on the traditional interest rate instruments. From a pure monetary policy point of view, it is entirely consistent to aim at negative rates when the real interest rate, equilibrium, real interest rate, has itself become negative. Speaking from the perspective of the ECB, negative rates have only been applied to the deposit facility rate, which banks use to credit funds to the ECB at overnight maturity, the excess reserves they have with us. The main objectives of this measure are twofold. First, to further lower money market rates and the longer end of the yield curve via expectation effects. Second, to increase the velocity of circulation of excess reserves in the interbank money market towards the banks that need liquidity to sustain or expand their credit portfolio. The banks with excess liquidity have an incentive to pass it on to other institutions or use it to fund new loans. We have had some success on both scores, and the stimulus to demand has benefited the European and global economies. Many market commentators link negative deposit facility rates mostly with exchange rate policy. This interpretation may have some degree of truth in what regards small open economies that are on the defensive side against pressures on their currencies, but do not work in the same way for big economies. In spite of the ECB's and Bank of Japan's decision to implement negative deposit facility rates both the euro and the yen have been appreciating against the dollar in the past months. There is no necessary link between the levels of deposit facility rates and exchange rates, as even the possibility of some form of carry trades depends on the general situation of risk aversion in the global economy. Additionally, recent empirical evidence points to a relatively limited pass-through of the exchange rate to the economy. It is nevertheless important to recall that there are clear limits to the use of negative deposit facility rates as a policy instrument. First, there is always the possibility of hitting the limit where the preference for cash withdrawals would set in, even if the threshold seems to be significantly distant in view of the costs of cash storage, safety, and insurance. Second, the instruments should not push banks to pass on their additional direct costs by turning deposit rates negative or increasing lending rates to increase margins. Both developments would be problematic. Tier systems, by just passing direct costs at the margin, can mitigate this concern, but cannot dispel it altogether. Overall, broadly counting all the effects that negative deposit facility rates have on banks' profitability, our analysis is that the aggregate result comes up positive for the euro area as a whole. Negative money market rates reduce the cost of funding for many banks. The lowering of yields for several assets produces capital gains, and the support to the recovery reduces impairment costs on non-performing loans. In more general terms, there has recently been quite some pushback against monetary policy in certain quarters, in particular questioning its effectiveness in the present situation. More sophisticated critics focus on the alleged exclusive short-term effects of monetary policy, which can only buy time for other policies to do the real job. The main common idea behind these arguments is the more general view that monetary policy is merely about the short term, with supply policies determining the longer term. This separation between the short and long term is an analytical device, a needed abstraction, to build simpler models and theories. However, such distinctions are artificial when we consider chronological historical time. Monetary policy can stimulate demand and investment, and as this creates productive capacity, a link is established with the supply side and the long term. Also, by speeding up the closing of output and/or unemployment gaps, monetary policy influences future potential output and growth. By avoiding protracted periods of recession, monetary policy helps avoid hysteresis that affects productive capital efficiency when equipment is not timely substituted or when the quality of human resources deteriorates by periods of long unemployment. Both forms of hysteresis influence the supply side and the long-term potential of the economy. As Keynes wrote, life and history are made up of short runs, which implies that the long run is just a sum of many different short terms. Monetary policy cannot be reduced to a short-term gimmick, since our economies do not spontaneously return quickly to zero output gaps and full employment. After the crisis, monetary policy responded forcefully everywhere, particularly in the US, with the early implementation of QE and credit easing measures. The US recovery has been stronger than in the euro area, and for 2016, buoyant growth was expected, accompanied by a gradual normalization of interest rates. This is a vital development for the world economy, and at the same time, an important proof that even with a restrictive fiscal policy, monetary policy can play a decisive role in generating a meaningful recovery and getting firmly away from the zero law bound. This would be a relevant disproval of the more somber views about the world economy system and monetary policy. Although this possibility is still very much alive, it has apparently been delayed by some mixed results since the fourth quarter of 2015. Turmoil in financial markets and the external environment seem to have affected the economy. In the blogosphere and some market literature, we could find some minority views speculating a possible double dip or significant slowdown, and the market's expectations for further rate increases this year became quite weak. Importantly, Chair Janet Yellen has said recently, and I quote, that while global financial developments could produce a slowing in the economy, I think we want to be careful not to jump to a premature conclusion about what is in store for the US economy. So we can continue to hope that the center of the world economy will hold and will prove its resilience independently of some external headwinds. On our side, the ECB has confronted the severe and persisting disinflationary forces affecting the euro area economy with a broad set of measures that I'm not going to dwell upon because they are well known. Given that monetary policy takes time to transmit to the real economy, the full effects of these measures on macroeconomic conditions have yet to fully materialize. However, the adjustment in financing conditions as a result of our monetary policy provides some encouraging signals. The reduction in lending rates in the whole euro area and the reduction of dispersion of lending rates among countries is one of such encouraging results. And also, we saw that as a result of our policies, in the bond market, there has been also a reduction of yields. And so the overall cost of capital, because there was also during a certain phase until the more recent turmoil, improvement in equity market, we can conclude that, and this in the fact, that indeed the cost of capital has been reduced as it was the main intention of the policies. And applying our models to build the counterfactual, because to measure the efficiency of any policy, we cannot just look through the window. As some time ago, Alan Blinder characterized some analysis. What was the situation at the beginning of the policy, and what is the situation now in terms of the outcomes? That's not the way to assess the effectiveness of a policy. We have to build a counterfactual. And to build a counterfactual means unavoidably using models that have some limitations, but that's the only way. And then we can show with various models that without our policies, we would have had last year an overall negative rate on average throughout the year. We would continue to be in deflation this year. And also in the last 2 years, our monetary policy contributed to 1/3 to 1/2 of all the growth that existed in the euro area in the last 2 years. And let me remind you that we have had positive growth in the previous 12 quarters. So since we came out of the double dip, we have been growing at moderate rates, but nevertheless growing. And that would not have happened without monetary policy. So, from a global perspective, monetary policy measures that strengthen the resilience of the domestic recovery do not amount to a zero-sum game in which different jurisdictions merely aim to debase their currency vis-à-vis each other. In fact, monetary policy accommodation by improving domestic credit conditions and stimulating nominal spending creates additional global demand rather than just leading to demand switching from one country to the other, as some observers have suggested. Notwithstanding a forceful response, monetary policy can only be one element of an encompassing policy mix. Other policy domains, both at national and European level, have to step up to their responsibilities to transform the prevailing uncertainty into a positive scenario. I refer naturally to a full use of any existent fiscal space, especially for infrastructure expenditures at the centralized level, to the continuation of structural reforms to improve the business climate, educational levels, judicial system efficiency, and product market competition, especially in services. And finally, to institutional progress at European level. This refers in particular to completing banking union and taking the first steps of fiscal union, thus proving the willingness of member states to create better conditions for the successfully functioning of a monetary union that can deliver stability and prosperity. Thank you for your attention.
I appreciate your clear picture of the situation, but the monetary policy is implemented by the European Central Bank in the framework of a field score in which use unemployment as a buffer stock. What about using the labor as a buffer stock in which the central bank fixes a minimum wage it's capable to finance any amount of supply of labor at this level? This is a counterfactual experiment, just a short-term experiment, which addresses directly the stability and the problem of achieving the 2% level. It's possible in the current framework. It's just a different tool which can work, it can work in the short run better than the current situation in which the central bank is trying to increase, to double the quantitative easing amount in the attempt to increase inflation. Thank you.
Well, remarks to your question. Well, first, of course, we could not fix any minimum wage, but also, let me say that in the present circumstances, where there is the economy is with an output gap that is negative, there is what Blanchard called the divine coincidence. By having an expansionary monetary policy, we deal at the same time with stimulating demand and growth, and also to increase inflation. So, there is, in this present situation, no such no contradiction between the two objectives, and so what we are doing is what a central bank indeed should do.
On negative rates, from time to time, the subject comes up in the United States. Mm-hmm. And even Janet Yellen has said that we would consider it in the event of a downturn. Mm-hmm. There seems to be a natural tendency in the U.S. financial markets for significant periods over the last year for rates to go down to or below the Fed's floor, mm-hmm. threshold floor, in the short-term treasury secondary market, which is the closest thing you could get to a proxy for what would happen in the absence of central bank intervention. And often those rates either go to the floor or sometimes all the way to negative territory as they currently do for inflation-corrected treasury securities. What do you think about the European experience with negative rates so far, should the United States consider the experiment of at least a brief period of negative rates before trying to allow rates to rise again,
yep.
just to clear the market? In other words, we have the impression that the market wants to go negative and the Fed won't let it.
Well, I don't know about that, but my view on your question is that the situations in Europe and the US are very much different. And in the stage of the economic cycle where the US economy is growing, as it is, much more than in Europe, I don't see really that the debate about negative rates in the US would make sense at this stage. Because the situation is quite different. And by the way, with general approval in December, the Fed started to increase rates. Then there was some international turmoil and some people changed their minds, but let's be not having such a short memory. Most market literature and analysts in December were okay with the beginning of the increase of rates in the US. So the economy is getting stronger. Investment is not yet buoyant, but it should come at immediate stage of the economic cycle. That is what is to be expected. Whereas in Europe, we are in a different situation. By the way, inflation also is higher in the US than in Europe. We have had two successive months of negative headline inflation in January and February. And the forecast of our staff that has been just published indicates a average inflation rate for this year of 0.1. So we are in a totally different universe. So according to that situation, what we did was to try indeed to brought down the whole spectrum of money market rates, reducing funding rates for the banks that use the interbank market to fund themselves, and help also that the yield curve was brought down, so the cost of financing and the cost of capital would follow the same pattern, and that's what we are doing. That is not justified for the US economy right now, in my view. Well, there are pessimists that indeed think, but they are a minority, that indeed think that the US could face slowdown. Well, then if that happens, that would be a different situation, but that's not the current situation in my view.
Yeah, I'd like to, I appreciate the overview that you gave us regarding the various, well, both your own opinion about the current state of affairs, and also that you did sort of pat yourself on the back for some growth in the system.
Yeah.
But I mean, you did say that you're practically in a deflationary environment still. So I mean, to say that, so you have some growth, but it's, you're at 0.1% of whatever inflation rate, exactly. But I would like to ask you something more precise, which has to do with the fact that you have currently, you have negative rates here, you're charging, you have banks here who are in a position right now where they are highly liquid, they have all these reserves in the system, just like they had it in the U.S. here. And my concern here is with the fact that, these banks, clearly, they do not need if we start from the premise that these banks do not need these reserves in order to carry out their commercial lending, okay? If that is the case, then why in the world are you taxing these banks when you're the ones who created those reserves and that they clearly cannot get rid of them, in the total picture of things here? They, even if one lends them the so-called reserves, it just happens to go somewhere else in the system.
Yes.
Yeah, so, unless you have the actual public holding more cash or something, there will not be any change there in the actual amount of, that the banks will be holding of those reserves. So all you're doing, in a sense, is taxing them indirectly.
No.
Well, so what is the object of that?
Well, I just mentioned what were the two objectives, the two main objectives of our policy. And of course, you are right, and some commentators get it wrong, that when a central bank creates monetary base and, say, excess reserves above what would be the minimum reserves, those reserves stay there in the balance sheet of the central bank. They are there. We hear, we can read sometimes, well, the banks are having those reserves idle in the central bank instead of passing them on to the economy. Well, they cannot pass them on, they are there. So, yes, but they there are two objectives. The first objective of doing that, I mean, deposit facility negative rates, as I said, was to brought down the whole spectrum of the money market rates until 1 year. And we achieved that. And that is important for many banks, not all banks, but many banks that still continue to fund themselves in the interbank market, in the wholesale market. So they get cheaper funding in those markets. Also, the banks, by having this situation, have been funding themselves this way, and so have been repaying medium-term bonds instead of reissuing medium-term bonds. So they have reduced the overall cost of their funding, which then is reflected in their lending rates that indeed have been going down. And those are the normal objectives of an expansionary monetary policy, is to bring down the cost of financing for the economy, and that has been achieved. At the same time, the second objective is, by having these negative rates, we create an incentive for the banks to increase the circulation of those reserves among themselves. It's important, because there are banks that have enough liquidity and have more deposits than credit, for instance. But there are other banks in the euro area that continue to finance themselves in the wholesale market, and so they would need and appreciate if the banks with more excess reserves in the central bank would lend them in the interbank market at negative rates. So that is the second purpose of this policy. And on both scores, we did indeed achieve our objectives. And to answer the question that indeed we are creating, not taxing, it's not a tax. That is, we charge, it's not a tax. But the answer to that question for the banks that indeed have to pay that for the excess reserves is that the overall effects of our policies indeed have improved the profitability of banks as a whole. Because, as I said, for some banks there is a reduction in the cost of funding. Second, our policy, by bringing down money market rates and medium and long-term rates, have induced capital gains in the banks in 2014 and 15 that were significant in their profit and loss accounts. By doing what we did and supporting the recovery, the impairment costs with the non-performing loans have been reduced in the euro area. And at the same time, last year, it was the first time that the net interest amount gained by the banks increased as a result of the increase in the volume of credit, which also is a result of our policies. So if you take all these effects, and not just the direct cost of paying for the excess reserves with the deposit facility rates, if you take all these effects, the net effect has been positive in the profitability of banks in the euro area. So that is important to consider this more general equilibrium effect and not just the direct cost of our policy. And that explains why we have done it. So that's my answer.
All right, so on this topic, so if I understand well, what you are saying is that with these negative rates of interest on reserves, you are inducing the banks with excess reserves, essentially from the north, to lend their reserves to the banks who are in deficit in the south, so as to hopefully, at the same time, reduce the target two balances. But wouldn't one be, okay, at some point during some of the presentations, we said that Japan was was telling us what might happen to other countries. Switzerland has had, you know, zero interest rates for a long time, so aren't you scared that in Europe you might see the same as in Switzerland, which is that, and I think you mentioned it briefly, which is that mortgage rates in Switzerland are now higher than they were before they had negative interest rates.
Yeah, that's why I said that there are limits to the policy of negative deposit facility rates. And so, yes, there are limits. It's not an instrument that can be used indefinitely. Well, and all the banks, all the central banks that have embarked into this are experimented and trying to see what is that, you know, that lower bound. And no one knows for sure. It's a matter of continue to experiment, of course, and that's what we have said that we are doing. So there is no natural threshold or a threshold that can be forecasted with certainty before we get there. So that is the gist of the situation. Of course, there are limits to what can be done, but it's just another instrument that is a complement to QE in terms of the effects of QE on longer maturities of longer term yields. So that's how we see this this policy that we have started. So
thank you. Central Bank of Norway. I think this was a very fascinating presentation. And it reminds me of an IMF paper on traditional monetary policy, where, you know, clearly the what is untraditional has been moving along as we're moving in time here. We had a discussion yesterday where many were saying that, you know, when are central banks going to admit that their ammunition is getting less and less traction? And also, I referred to Ms. Lagarde's comment that monetary policy probably no shouldn't be the alpha and omega, and I think she was clearly alluding to perhaps an expanding role for fiscal policy. But obviously, this is a political issue. So I mean, I don't expect her to address that. But it really and the two questions then poses the following, the two issues posed to the following question. I mean, if we can agree that there are less pressure, I mean, there is sort of a marginal decrease in the efficiency of monetary policy, but there are strong resistance to fiscal policy. I mean, what are the options? I mean, we heard in the last panel that there was, you know, you could do some technical things, maybe. And I guess my question to you would be, to comment A on Edward Turner's idea of helicopter money. I was surprised when he presented this at the IMF conference, I think last fall, that Lars Svensson, who I expected to be opposing his proposal, actually admitted that that was a pretty sensible technical proposal, and he didn't have very strong objections. So what are your view on helicopter money, or are there any alternative that could be even more untraditional in terms of which type of monetary policy instruments central banks could employ, given the fact that there are both ideological and practical limitations to fiscal policy?
Mm-hmm. It is, in a way, true, and this morning it was also recalled, that the central banks are in a situation where if other policies do not help, then we have, you know, to do our job. We have a mandate. Inflation is very low in Europe. We are away from our explicit target for inflation. So we have to apply an expansionary monetary policy. And that policy has effects, as I just mentioned before, which are not just you know, measured by looking, well, you have started last year with more aggressive policy, but the inflation is now zero. Okay, it would have been quite negative if we had not done that. And that's what came out of several models, not just one model, not just you know, Phillips curves or whatever, several models to produce a counterfactual. So that's part of my answer. And indeed, what comes out of part of the literature that I mentioned about global liquidity traps is indeed that fiscal policy would be an answer. But for various reasons, either because many countries have already very high debt ratios, and this and that, and political disputes in some countries, it's not happening anywhere. So that's it. So, helicopter money. Well, first let me say that, you know, with such low interest rates, particularly in Europe, for governments, you know, helicopter money would not make a big difference because they could already fund increase in expenditure at very, very, very low interest rates. So 10-year bonds for Germany are now at 16 basis points, and 5 years are negative. So, yeah. So who needs helicopter money? It's something that, of course, we are very much limited by the treaty to embark upon. So, and that's then perhaps for other countries that do not have a legal mandate as we have, but it's something that we could not contemplate. But as I say, you know, it's interest rates as a result of our policy are so low that indeed that would not be certainly an obstacle to an increase in expenditure. There are other reasons.
Mr. Constancio, you explained very well that the negative rates are an expectation for even longer rates to bring the yield curve down. So, but in spite of that, as this gentleman pointed out, net-net, if the banks cannot pass on negative rates, that is, if the banks cannot pass on negative rates, it is effectively a bank tax. And I sort of agree with this gentleman, but we can choose to disagree. The point, though, is it is at also some level fiscally protectionary. We're taking euros out of the system.
Well, right? But we are, you know, issuing a lot of euros with other elements of our policy, so you cannot just analyze the thing, you know, separately.
Well, no, if you set up your fiscal spending and then you take out euros 0.5% a year, it's fiscally contractionary. Where is the euro, other euros coming from?
No, sorry, we are buying government bonds and creating money to pay for them. So that's what we are doing. So we are increasing our high-powered money, our monetary base, whatever you want to call it, by huge amounts that much more than offset the meager result that you are quoting that we are doing by taking out euros from circulation. So there is no comparison. You have to see all of the policies that we are applying and what are the global effects, and also on the profitability of banks, I precisely explain that there are other effects that must be countered.
I understand the profitability issue. So having said that, though, bringing the lower rates down, so let's say the bank lending rates go from 2% to 1.5%, well, there are some projects that wouldn't have financed at 2%, but would finance at 1.5%. But that is kind of marginal. Are you also worried about some of the issues that came up with the U.S., which is why should well-rated companies go and issue bonds and buy their stuff back? Because that would be a logical thing to do. If you can borrow money for 10 and 20 or 30 years and sub 2%, maybe that's what. So are you concerned that you might distort equity prices this way?
Well, you know, I don't think that you can rationalize a policy by firms that have their own business model just by taking advantage of issuing debt and then buying their own stocks. That has limits, and it's not really something. But again, as it was very well discussed and explained here in the US when QE started, one of the channels of transmission of QE is precisely that rebalancing portfolio effect, meaning that by buying government bonds and injecting money, then the investors who sold the government bonds do something with that money, and that will then have repercussions in other financial asset markets, including equities. Yes, and that's part of the objective of the policy, which is to bring down the cost of capital. And that's what monetary policy is about. And the second thing is, I know that, negative deposit facility rates, negative rates create this problem. But in pure now economic terms, and I very seldom do that in pure economic terms, but in pure economic terms, one has to reason in real terms. You know, in real terms, and if indeed the real equilibrium rate is now negative, and that's a situation that was not created by monetary policy, by all means, it was not created by monetary policy. We are just adjusting to that new reality, which is unfortunate, but has other explanations. And that is important also for investment projects, because proper decisions about investment projects should also be done in real terms, not in nominal terms. I know that in spite of all the rationality assumptions of economics that are excessive, there is a lot of money illusion out there, contrary to, thinking, the more orthodox thinking of economics that really thinks in real terms. So I will qualify this, but that, on first approximation, is true.
One last question, please. Yes. I thought you mentioned something about fiscal union.
Yeah.
What did you mean by that?
Well, it's there is a report which was issued recently, the so-called Five Presidents Report. I mean, the President of the European Union, the President of the European Parliament, the President of the ECB, the President of the Eurogroup, the President of the Commission. Five presidents issued a report about the path towards a genuine monetary union. And there is a chapter there about steps to fiscal union, a very long-term thing. But indeed, initial steps that are mentioned there, and that, of course, as also counterparts of conditions for that movement to be possible. But for instance, the allusion that it is there to a sort of a additional budget at the European level for Euro area countries that would be used to smooth out, the economic cycle in members of the Euro area. That would be part of that very embryonic step, but it is alluded, and there is a chapter in that Five Presidents report about the long, very long-term objective. So that's what I was referring to.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.